For this opportunity to present this very recent work. And as you can see from the title, I will start from a quantum dynamic, and I will get a classical one. So this is exactly in the middle between the quantum community and the classical one. And so to start with, I would like to present the system I want to consider. So at a microscopic level, we will look at a system of fermions and interacting fermions, and we will consider the case in which we have n particles which are fermions in the phase space, and we want to consider the first approximation soon after the Schrödinger equation to this kind of problem. And this is well known fact that is given by the Hartree-Fock equation, which is an equation for the one particle reduced density matrix, omega, which is an operator which satisfies this equation here, where here epsilon plays the role of the usual h-bar, so the Planck constant. On the left-hand side, you have the time derivative in the quantum framework, and on the right-hand side, you have this commutator structure of the operator itself with an Hamiltonian, which is the one related to the Hartree-Fock dynamics, which is given by essentially two parts. The first one, which is the kinetic energy, with the usual epsilon square, which is the right, the usual scaling, and the second term, which represents the interaction, which is given by two parts. The first one, which is is called the direct term, which is nothing else than the convolution of the spatial density rho, which is defined here, with the interacting potential V that we will assume to be regular enough. And then there is another term which is called the exchange term and is defined here. So about these two parts, this one, so because of the definition of this spatial density, this is nothing else than the 1 over n the kernel of the one particle reduced density matrix evaluated, let's say, along the diagonal, while the other one is a sort of convolution out diagonal, let's say. So what we want to do with this system, so we want to perform a semi-classical analysis and to get in the limit when epsilon goes to zero, so when the Planck constant goes to zero, we want to see which is the solution to the Hartree-Fock, which kind of solution approach. And this problem is a... There are a lot of papers on these topics, and what is expected is that solution to the Hartree-Fock equation converts to solutions to the Vlasov equation. And the Vlasov equation is something you all are familiar with. So I write it here again for completeness. We have an equation for the probability density function in the one particle phase space. So let me give some motivation. So the true motivation is we want to start from the true quantum dynamics given by the Schrödinger equation and to get in some limit the Vlasov equation. So this was done for the first time by Narnofer and Sevel in 1981 for analytic potential, and in the same year by Herbert-Spohn for C2 potentials. And it was It was done, but without an explicit rate of convergence for this particular class of potential. And then another school, let's say, another way to see this problem is to split it into two parts. So first we look at the convergence of the Schrödinger equation to the Hartree-Fock, and then we scale from Hartree-Fock to Vlasov. And with this respect, there is this paper of 2003 by Bardos, Goltz, Gottlieb and Mauser, which in a mean field limit, they get, which is not coupled with a semi-classical one, they found the convergence in a weak sense, so without an explicit rate, for bounded potentials. Then very recently, in the last year, in 2013, Niels Benedetter, Marcello Porta and Benjamin Schlein, under weaker assumptions on the potential, they find an explicit estimate for the rate of convergence. And so in the previous work, this was done only towards the Hartree dynamics, which is essentially the Hartree-Fock without the exchange term. And they were able to do it also for the Hartree-Fock. And this was done only for states which are at zero temperature, which are usually called pure states in quantum mechanics. And very recently, with Benedetter, Porta, Jaksic, Schlein, and myself, we extended these convergence results to the more general case of positive temperature. So we consider also mixed states, more general than the usual Slater determinants, using the abstract Araki-Wiese representation. So the next step is to find the rate of convergence from the Hartree dynamics, or Hartree-Fock, that is almost the same, towards the Vlasov 1. This means at this point we have an explicit rate of convergence from the many-body quantum dynamics to the Hartree-Fock level, and we want to get another rate of convergence in order to control each step of our scaling. So, to this respect, there are two works in 1993, one by Lyons and Thierry Paul, and the other one by Markovic and Mauser, in which they are able to control to reach the convergence in a weak sense, so again without an explicit rate, but for Coulomb potential, which was great goal, for positive temperature, so for mixed states. And in 2011, with further assumptions on the potential, which has to be regular enough, Athanasoulis, Paul, Pezzotti and Pulvirenti, they found out an explicit rate of convergence, which is of this order. So where here this parameter alpha is a positive parameter strictly less than one, again for positive temperature. So this was an important result because it's the first result with an explicit rate of convergence, but so of course this rate of convergence is far from being the optimal one. So these series of references are all motivations. But maybe the deeper motivation is that the results I'm going to present are a subpart of a project in collaboration with Niels Benedetter, Marcello Porta and Benjamin Schlein, Niels in Rome and Marcello and Benjamin in Zurich. So a subpart of this problem is to see this convergence from many-body quantum dynamics to Hartree-Fock and from Hartree-Fock to the Vlasov equation for zero temperature and for positive temperature, so for pure and mixed states with explicit rate of convergence. So this part has been done in the last 2 years, and now what I want to do in this talk is to explain how we deal with this second limit. So before to start with the more technical part, I have a remark. So the fact that we consider the Hartree-Fock dynamics or the Hartree-1, it makes not a big difference, because it was proved even for mixed and for poor states that indeed the exchange term is subleading with respect to the others. So we are able to prove some kind of convergence in time, in for exponential time, to the from Hartree-Fock to Hartree. So at the end it will be not that important the appearance of the exchange term, at least in the case in which this potential is sufficiently smooth. So let me be more precise for which is the big difference between the zero temperature and the positive temperature for a quantum system. So at zero temperature, so imagine to have your system of N fermions trapped by an external potential and in thermal equilibrium. So this kind of states are expected and proved to be close to a Slater determinant, which is a particular type of states that we don't want to enter in this context. But what is important to know is that to this particular quantum states, there is one particle reduced density we can associate to it, and a good property of this operator is that it's an orthogonal projection. While for positive temperature, the situation is a bit different, because the kind of states we want to look at are quasi free states on the Fock space, and here the important thing is that we can associate to it a reduced density omega n, but this density is only an operator in between 0 and 1 with trace n, and so we don't know if it's a projection or not. So of course Slater determinants are a subcase of quasi free, so are an example, let's say, of quasi free states, but for positive temperature we have much more states than only Slater determinants. So there is a big gap in between these two situations. So for zero temperature we will call this particular quasi-free state pure, and an important property of this kind of operators is that the Wigner transform of this one is essentially a characteristic function. So it's not much, we cannot differentiate it twice, for example. We don't have a lot of regularity on it. While for positive temperature, we will call it mixed quasi-free states, and in this case, the Wigner transform is smooth. So just to recall, for those of you who are not familiar with the Wigner transform, the Wigner transform is a transformation which, if you take the kernel of an operator, you can pass to a function on the one particle phase space, and then you can define the same way the anti-Wigner transform starting from a function on the one particle phase space, and you get the kernel of an operator. So here I will assume this particular scaling because we are looking at operators with trace n. So I want this one to be order 1 and this one to be of trace n. Okay, so the main result will be to compare the solution to the Hartree-Fock equation with a solution to the Vlasov equation, but you see that they live into different spaces, and of course the Wigner transform is a useful tool to put them in the same space. And the idea is we start from an initial data, W0, in the one particle phase space. It is a probability density. on the one particle phase space. And then we let it evolve according to the Vlasov dynamics, and we get a WT. Then we perform the Wigner transform, or I mean, in this case, the anti-Wigner transform, and we get a certain omega nt tilde, which will solve the equivalent of the Vlasov equation in this new space, and the new equation is this one. We have a commutator part, which is the part due to the kinetic energy, and then we have another part which has not a commutator structure, and this operator A is defined this way. So the kernel of this operator is the gradient of the convolution of the potential with the spatial density in a middle point, x plus y divided by 2, times x minus y. On the other side, we take this initial data and we transform it with the Wigner transform, and we get an initial data omega n zero, and then we let it evolve with the R3 or R3 Fock dynamics, and we get our omega nt. So at this point, we can compare these two because they are on the same space. Okay, so the first result I want to show you is a result about the convergence in trace norm for mixed states. So we look at positive temperature, and we will get we will use the fact that we look at this mixed state, so we can assume some regularity on the initial data, and we look at potentials which are somehow regular, C2 and bounded, and we assume on the initial data that this norm is conserved. So this is an L2 norm in X and V with these weights, and this alpha here is a multi-index, so we can consider up to 5 derivatives with respect to X or V mixed derivatives. Then we get an explicit rate for the trace norm that is the optimal one. And this constant here depends in exponential in time. So we can do a bit something else. So if we also add on the potential the hypothesis that the Fourier coefficients of the potential have a certain decrease, then we can slow a bit down the hypothesis on the initial data, and this multi-index is just smaller or equal than 1, and we get this result in the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. So we can, this is what is expected to be the optimal rate of convergence, and we can compare it with the results by Mario and co-authors. So there is a big improvement so from one end for the potential we are considering it, and from the other end from the rate of convergence we get. So as you can imagine, the proof will be to look at this trace norm and try to estimate it. So what I want to do now is just to give you the idea of why the proof is working without giving any technical details, and you can ask me later if you are interested. So the first thing we look at this difference between the solution to the Hartree-Fock equation and the one associated to the Vlasov equation. We perform the time derivative, and then we suddenly stop because already in the first term we have this nasty kinetic energy which we are not able to bound. So how can we get rid of it? So the nice idea, or at least I think it's nice, is to define an auxiliary dynamics which can somehow cancel this term. And so we define a unitary operator which satisfies this equation. So it evolves according to a certain Hamiltonian that can be the Hartree-Fock or the Hartree-1. So in this case, we can consider, instead of considering this quantity, we can consider the one with the unitary operator, the adjoint of the unitary operator on the left-hand side and the unitary operator on the right-hand side. And of course, since then we want to take the trace norm, this will not affect it because they are unitary operators. So we perform the time derivative, so we have to derive this term, and this term. So from the derivative of this, of the two unitary operator, we get a commutator structure. And from here, we get these other terms. And you see that the first one and the second one cancel exactly. And they are the only two in which the kinetic energy is appearing. So somehow we overcome the problem we have this with the Laplacian. So we are left only with these terms. So here I'm adding and subtracting the same term I have here, but for the spatial density related to the Vlasov equation. So I'm left only with the terms which are related to the potential energy. So I have to bound this, and I rewrite it in this way. So here you see I have this nice difference of the density, which of course is related to the difference I have on the left-hand side. And then I have this other operator, which is of this, with the kernel of it is of this form. So I integrate in time, and I get these three terms. And what I want to do now is to take the trace norm so that I'm left with this inequality. So on the left-hand side, I have the trace norm of the difference. Then I have the initial data, and then this 1 over epsilon of this commutator here in trace norm plus another term. So the idea is the following. We want to have something. So thanks to this rho s minus rho tilde s, we want to let appear on the right-hand side the same trace norm at time s, in order to get a Gronwald type estimate. And we have this 1 over epsilon here, so we also want to extract from this commutator structure a term which is small in epsilon, in order to cancel this one. And then from the second one, we expect it to be small, so we want to extract from this trace norm an epsilon square in order to get at the end something which is order epsilon. So we focus on the first term. And so the first thing is to look at this rho s minus rho tilde s. And if you perform this easy computation using the variational formulation for the trace norm, you can see that it is indeed bounded by 1 over n the trace norm of this. So now what I'm doing now is not rigorous, but I want to give you the ideas. Of course, everything has to be done in a proper way, and this is what we did. But the idea is that it works because this trace norm here is the product of two parts, one which is the trace norm of what we had on the left-hand side, and the other one which is another commutator, which is somehow the nothing else than epsilon n times the L1 norm of the gradient of, of the solution to the Vlasov equation. So here I'm putting this bracket because this is true, this equality, only in the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. So we know from semi-classical analysis that if we have the trace norm, that we have other corrections to this term. And indeed, we did it in such a way that we can pass to the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, but the idea is essentially the same. So we have this epsilon here, which comes epsilon n, which comes from the scaling. So this n cancelled the n we have here, and this epsilon cancelled the epsilon 1 over epsilon in front of the time integral. So we are left here inside with this trace norm and this gradient of a solution to the Vlasov equation, which is bounded from the one at time zero, thanks to the nice properties of the Vlasov dynamics. Then we have the second term, and in the second term we want to get it small. And so roughly the idea is essentially as before, and at least, very very formally, the idea is that if you expand this to the second order, then you get the second derivative of this quantity times the x minus y to the square, and this gives you, in the operator sense, this double commutator structure. And what we expect is that if the Wigner transform of this operator is regular enough, then we can get an epsilon square here. So an epsilon, one epsilon for each commutator, let's say. So very naively, this is the idea. So we can conclude by Gronwald lemma. We have this difference in trace norm on the left-hand side, and then on the right-hand side, we have this coefficients here that are bounded with the same one at time zero, thanks to the Vlasov properties, and then the difference in trace norm at time s. So this is the idea of the proof, and of course this works only for mixed states, so for zero temperature. If you want to consider for positive temperature, if you want to consider the case of zero temperature, so to look at pure states, we have to deal with the fact that the Wigner transform is not regular enough. So, for example, if we have an initial state which is only in H1 and not in H2, then the theorem fails and we are not anymore in the setting, in the hypothesis of the previous theorem, but what we can do is something which is anyway not too bad, and as far as I know is the first result about zero temperature in this framework. So what we obtain is a less strong convergence, because it's a convergence against a semi-classical observable on which we assume some regularity at initial time. And with this hypothesis on the potential, so some decreasing on the Fourier coefficient, we get this convergence in this weaker sense, but anyway with an explicit rate of convergence. So if we get the initial data to be the same, of course we have done. Okay, so I think I have 5 minutes, right? Okay, so I want to end with some perspectives. So the one thing that we are working on now is to look at the excitation spectrum for the ground state, so starting from the ground state, and we want to compare the spectrum of the excited Dartree-Fock dynamics with the one given by the usual Schrödinger many-body quantum dynamics. But this is maybe a bit far away from this community. What is more challenging is maybe to look at the Coulomb potential for this case. So, and with respect to that, we are very far away, even for the first part, so starting from many body to Hartree-Fock. And so it was done only in a different scaling for very small time, or if you want, for a scaling in which the potential is not that important. So the interaction is essentially, so it's essentially the free interaction. So it's no interaction. And the Coulomb potential was treated for the case from R3 to Vlasov, but without any rate of convergence, and the convergence in a weak star sense, so it's quite difficult to extract from it an explicit rate, let's say. So this would be actually a very nice result, but unfortunately we are far away to slow down the hypothesis on it. And then, to end, it would be very interesting to consider other scaling. So one first thing could be we perform the mean field from the Medi-Body to the R3 Fock, and then we couple it with this semi-classical scaling, but at the R3 Fock level we rescale it with a kind of a weak coupling limit. And what is expected, but not at all proved, and far to be proved, is that these dynamics converge to the quantum Boltzmann for fermions. So this would be a very interesting result, but it's very hard to get, of course, as you can imagine. And so this is actually the big goal. And then, I mean, in the for what concerns the first part, what would be also interesting is to look at scalings which leads to the Hubbard models, and to see whether one can use it to go farther beyond the quantum Boltzmann. So these are all big problems, and maybe the Coulomb one is maybe the more approachable. And so with this I conclude, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Is there any question or comment?
So in your nice pictures of the beginning with the different scalings, where would you put then the nonlinear Schrödinger limit that you can? Or
here.
Yeah.
So here we have the standard the standard Schrödinger equation with a potential, yeah. And we scale it, so we look at time of order one, so we have I epsilon dt, and we have the epsilon square on the other time, so on the other side in front of the Laplacian. And we are coupling n and epsilon, so the number of particle and epsilon in a mean field way, but we are not taking it to infinity because the two limits comes together, right? So if they are coupled in a mean field way, so n epsilon square is order one, epsilon cube, sorry. Then when you perform the limit for n which goes to infinity is the same of epsilon going to zero and so on. So here n at the R3 Fock level is fixed. So it's mean field in the sense that we take it to be order one, but we are not taking n which goes to infinity. This is something so it's a limit we perform in the next step. It's just, was this the question?
I don't think so, but maybe. I mean, in this picture, I would expecting to see somewhere something like a nonlinear Schrödinger equation.
So
nonlinear Schrödinger, I mean. Is it exactly the same thing?
Is it just another way? So you translate it, that you translate your many-body quantum dynamics given by the usual, so that you have your kinetic equation and then the usual potential, so this is the Schrödinger equation you are considering, and then you just translate it, let's say, in a system of equations on this reduced particle, reduced density matrix. But you are not, So it's exactly, so n is fixed and they're exactly at the same level. It's something which came from the study of the ground states. So it's expected, so at ground state level, you know that this R3FOC is exactly the minimizer, the solution to this equation is exactly the minimizer of the energy of the ground state.
Thank you. We have time for one more question, maybe? Not more. No? Okay, so let's thank that.